YouTube, welcome back. This session, we're going to be looking at some more CSS techniques, things like pseudo classes, to really give our CSS a bit more interactivity and make it more interesting to look at. As always, please don't forget to like and subscribe down below. There are comments in the description with links to code examples and things like that, as well as a new Slack channel that we've opened up. You can join the Slack channel if you send me an email on phil@electrocatstudios.com. I will add you to the channel and you can join in. Basically, the channel is for anyone who has any questions at all about software or hardware or projects they're working on. You can go along there and get some help from either the community or from myself. Without further ado, let's get started.
So, the first thing that we can use in CSS is a pseudo class. A pseudo class represents the state of a particular item in HTML, and it means we can change it when we interact with it. Here's an example of the hover pseudo class. This one changes the background color to yellow whenever the cursor is hovering over the element. And there are numerous examples of where this sort of thing is used in buttons, picture captions, items expanding when you hover over them, but also like menu items and things like that, and many more. There are lots of creative ways that you can use these. Some other pseudo classes that are available are active, which is when the user is clicking on an item, so the button has gone down but not come up again. A link, typically this is to override the standard link behavior of being blue and underlined. This isn't really used anymore. Generally, you would restyle in raw CSS rather than using the link and visited attributes, but you could create your own if you wanted to. Also, the focus attribute. This one is very useful. It can do things like adding a border around a text input when you click into it. A focus just means simply that that is where the cursor is, and if you were to start typing, that is where text would appear. If we open up brackets, we can give those a go. So let's create a new file and call this CSS pseudo, short for CSS pseudo classes, and create the usual elements within. Let's now create the same square red box that we saw in the last example. Don't forget, when we reference the class, we need to use a dot. If it was an ID, we'd need to use a hash. And then when we're ready, click on the preview button. And there we have our red box again. Now let's add our pseudo class. We do that like this. And now that we've done that, let's give it a go. Now we can see we have our red box as before. And when we roll over, it turns yellow. In this case, because the color of the text is set to yellow, we then can't see the text underneath. So let's have a go at changing that as well. As we can see now, when we roll over, the text goes red and it kind of flips the colors on us. We also might like to change the pointer to make it look like a button. We do that by writing cursor colon pointer. And we can see when we roll over, it now looks more like a link. Makes it feel more interactive for a user using the page. CSS also allows us to add transitions into our styles, which means that we can fade nicely between all of the different styles. That may not sound that important, but it can really add a nice feel to a web page. Transitions can get really complex. There are tons of different things that you can do with them. However, I recommend a really good starting point is just to take this example, transition all 0.5 seconds ease, and then have a play around with the time to see how that changes things. And let's try putting that in now. And so we add our transition here. And we can try running it. And now you see it does a nice smooth transition to the new color. You'll notice that it snaps back when we roll off. The reason for that is because the transition only applies when hovering. As soon as you're not hovering anymore, it doesn't apply to the style. So we need to put it into both the hover state and the original state as well. And now we can see it fades nicely between both of the different styles. Let's try changing this to 3 seconds instead of 0.5 seconds. And we see we get a nice longer lasting fade out when we leave the contents of the box. The transition itself, just to break down what it actually means, all means apply this to all styles. In some of the more complex variations, which I urge you to Google if you're interested in this, you can specify specific styles for it to target. The next one is obviously the time, the length of time from the beginning state to the end state and fading through. And ease. Ease means to ease in and ease out. You can also specify ease in or ease out, or you can just leave it off completely to give you a linear transition. I quite like ease in, ease out, which is why I use it on most of my transitions. Rounded corners can also be added to our styles, and this gives us much more of a like button-like feel. You'll notice in these examples, there are 3 different styles. There are, in fact, more than this. I just wanted to cover what these are. So you might see border radius. Now that's a fairly standard looking CSS style. You can also see dash moz dash border radius and dash webkit dash border radius. These ones are specific to particular browsers. Dash moz obviously relates to Mozilla Firefox, and webkit refers to Safari and also Chrome. They use the same rendering engine underneath, or at least they used to. The reason for these extra styles is because browsers don't or aren't able to implement The reason for these styles is because browsers aren't able to implement their implementations of CSS styles all at the same time. And so you might find that certain browsers will introduce them first or do it a non-standard way before they become part of the HTML standard. This means that you may need to include these to make sure that older browsers can also cope with the styles that you're adding. However, for border radius, it is now supported by all major browsers. So you don't, in fact, need to include this. I just wanted to include a side note to make you aware. There are some other advanced CSS attributes, many, many more, that we didn't cover. Some of them include gradient fills, drop shadows, curved edges, simple patterns, and even images as backgrounds. We'll cover some of these in future lessons. If you want particularly to know about any of these, please leave a message in the comments and we'll try and make a new video soon. So let's try adding border radius to our red box and see what happens. And now let's preview the style. As we can see, it's curved the corners for us. When we roll over, it still keeps that style. Let's try something else. Let's try adding a different border radius when we hover over. Of 0 pixels and see what happens. Now when we roll over, we see the corners fold themselves back out. And of course, we're still taking 3 seconds to return to that previous state. Gives us a better view of what's going on.
Thank you very much for joining us. Hope you've got something out of that, learned some more about CSS and the ways that it can be used, including some more of the advanced techniques that we've been looking at today. As always, please don't forget to like and subscribe down below. There's also a link at the end of this video. Any questions, please leave them in the comments and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. See you next time.